just as a gig. We're also really excited to premiere a work that was written by a composer whose sax concerto was written for our own Dr. Nabb. We played it here about 4 years ago, and not long after Dr. Gross left, he said, "I had a great time. I wrote this for you." And he had read Brad Modlin, our Reynolds Chair of Creative Writing, had read a book of his poetry. He had enjoyed meeting various people who become soloists. And he ended up writing this piece, not just because he thought we were all so great here in the music department, but also because he was really inspired by Brad's work. And Robert had mentioned last night that he specifically picked three specific poems from there that he felt were connected sort of in theme. And I thought maybe we were fortunate enough to have a poet here. So please welcome Brad Moth.
So the three poems that Robert Gross has set to music are poems about love and anxiety. And the characters wonder if they can find love, and if they can find it, can it last? And can it last in our unpredictable world? I miss this. 7 months until our third anniversary. I'm sleepy and somehow restless, but I'm in our front yard with you and a box of Dutch iris bowls. I try to want this. You wear your teacher voice and describe the quasi-precision. Holes about 6 inches apart and two thumbs deep. Hold the trowel upright and twist down. Your lecture goes too far. If watered in summer, certain irises disappear, which is a euphemism the gardeners use. You don't answer when I ask how to tell if these are that type. It's a chilly Sunday morning in October, and the air tempts with exhaust from cars headed somewhere else. I'm sorry for thinking that. But I stay put, fold my anxious legs beneath me. Folk wisdom says if a couple can last their first 3 years, and slip the trowel from your fist, take hold of your hand like it's fragile glass, press your thumb and mine into the dirt until my wrist shakes. My cousin sets me up with the woman, she sure is the one. When, unfortunately, I tell my date I know some Spanish, she says, "I'm a native speaker." I hide my big mouth with a glass of water. She says, "Say something." "Es una examen?" I ask. "Yes, it is a test, basically," she answers. I say, "It's only our first date. Are we ready for a romance language?" She stares, and her black eyes are so gorgeous, I think I can swim in them for a year. "It's just that I want to construir una buena impresión," I say. It's possible that this woman is my last chance. My next birthday is a scary one, and no one has whispered my name for a very long time. Today's horoscope suggested I learn to live happily alone. I don't know where you heard build a good impression, but it should be quiero empezarte. Because I often use self-deprecation as permission to fail, I say, estoy horrible con la gramática. It should be soy, she says. Estoy means I'm only currently horrible. Soy is correct. It means horrible for always. The Neutron Bomb, Afterward. Just the rain clouds remember how to move in this city of rotting bird nests and unfinished bottles, where you and I are the only living things. Most mornings I watch them alone at the window as they float over streets of empty taxi cabs. You spend whole days asleep. You say you dream of geraniums, mosquitoes, my grandmother, the boy who delivered the daily paper. We are no longer enough for each other. Our words, too, are becoming incomplete. We are afraid one of us will finally voice the question. But haven't we been asking it for generations, demanding explanation for famine, shattered heirlooms, children silenced by ocean floors? And still, for centuries, we have been surprised by sudden deafness, red knives slipping into thumbs.
Shut up.